Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Today is a revision of the study that I took in the Gospel of John. John was the youngest disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, who was known to be loved by him the most. He confesses that his record is true. The Holy Ghost has given many rich information through John in this book. We began to study this book about 5 years ago, but for some unknown reason I stopped it. Sorry for that. Now I am starting it again. So as I begin, I'm taking the revision of the portions that I have covered already. That is up to John chapter 3, verse 12. It was 8 sessions before. Now I will take the revision in 2 sessions. Then I'm planning to continue the book to complete it. So today is the revision number 1. Which will cover the first chapter only. John chapter 1 verse 1 says, John chapter 1 verse 1, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Here, the beginning was the existence of God even before the creation. First verse says about 2 persons. There was God and there was the Word. So Word and God, there's 2. They both were God. Verse 2 says that there was another God who was the Spirit of God. These 3 distinctly separate persons having one and only omnipotent Spirit as their body. So God is 3 persons in one omnipotent Spirit. Then God the Father created all things by Jesus Christ as the Spirit of God was helping him. God created lights on the first day and on the 4th day. The 4th day creation was the lights as sun, moon, etc. And it was a physical illumination that we all see. The 1st day creation was the light that was spiritual illumination, and it was the Spirit that gives life to the soul. Jesus Christ is a custodian of this light. He gives it or lights it on anybody who will come to him from the world. John the Baptist also was witnessing to people all about Jesus Christ. It is up to verse 9. God has separated the light from the darkness. This light and the darkness are symbolic, or we may say they are spiritual. They are like truth and lie, good and evil, righteousness and unrighteousness, holiness and sin, spirit and flesh, just and unjust, and so on. They cannot unite or merge together, but people like to have a middle ground. We don't want both extremes, and we want to survive in the middle happily, happy medium. But there's no middle ground on this. Jesus Christ gave the Spirit, our light, to us so that we may live in him, not in the world. So that is, there's either this or that. It's clearly explained in verse 4 to 13. And verse 12 says, verse 12, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. We must receive him believing on his name. His name is Lord Jesus Christ. So if we receive him as Lord of our life, then only he will give power to become sons. If we receive power from him, we will become the sons of God. Then we will inherit heaven as the sons of God, which is much glorious than the paradise. The Bible says that the sons will be like, exactly like Jesus Christ himself, shine with all his glory in heaven. That'll be very glorious. John chapter, same thing, verse 14 says, and the Word was made flesh. That is, God became a man. The Word is God, and then he became flesh, means flesh man. How God can become a man? The soul of God, the Word, left the omnipotent Spirit body of God and entered the flesh body that was created in the womb of Mary. Thus God became a man. If you like to know the details, you may look at my other videos, or please write to me and then I will answer you from the scripture. My email address is teacher@truegospel.com. teacher@truegospel.com, that's my email address. There's also even the board written here, truegospel.com, that's my email address. And so I will answer you promptly. Bible says God became flesh, which is meat. Flesh is meat. It is to indicate that he made himself as ordinary man. Romans chapter 8 verse 3 says that he was like a sinful flesh, not glorious flesh. That's flesh, flesh is flesh. So he was made a sinful flesh, yet he did not commit any sin. He was 100% man when he was a man, according to the Bible. Even though preachers say that he was 100% man and 100% God, I don't know how. I have other videos and articles proving that he lived only as 100% man with the favor of God. You may always write to me to clear any doubt if you have any doubt. Verse 16, of his fullness have all we received grace for a grace. Every Christian liked this verse. And the verse says that we all received grace. It is in the past tense, received. So it is done. But it is written for the true believers only, not the whole world. So the whole world don't get this grace, just the believers. What is grace and who gives grace? It is the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ, who is here now, and he is in the omnipotent spirit. We must remember this. I'm saying is, when we should say Jesus, we may settle for a man in Jewish robe for Jesus. That is the pictures we see all the time, with the long hair, with the beard, and with the robe. And so we, oh yeah, that is Jesus. No, that's not Jesus. Jesus is in the omnipotent spirit. And he's, we cannot see him because he's God now. The person we may see in the pictures and those kind of things, or people say visions, they say, in a man in the robe, and he could be another Jesus. Bible warns us not to be deceived by another Jesus. Another Jesus gives another grace. So, what is grace? And Second Corinthians, verse 12, chapter 12, verse 9. Second Corinthians, chapter 12, verse 9. It says, Paul says, he said unto me, that means Jesus Christ, said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness most gladly. Therefore I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. So that's what he says, the power of Christ may rest upon me. Paul defines grace. Grace is the power that Jesus Christ give it to Paul. This grace gives strength to him when he is weak, when Paul is weak, and Jesus gives the power to him so that he becomes strong. That's the power, he just injects the power, then Paul became strong. When he is about to fall because of his weakness, the strength of God lift him up, and so he will not fall. Grace of God will not say, go ahead and fall for sins, and I have died for you on the cross. No, it is another grace. It is a grace of the deceivers, the theologians, the preachers, and the humanitarians, and all these kind of people say that. But grace of God gives us power to defeat sin. Romans chapter 5, verse 21 says that, as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. So the word says that if we are sinning people, we You know, as sin has reigned under us, if you are sinning people, then the sin will reign over us, rule over us. It will bring you to eternal death. In the same way, if we have grace, then grace rules over us. Grace is not under us, grace is over us. We are under grace. Grace rules over us by Jesus. So when you say grace, Jesus comes and rules over us. That's what called grace. And it is through righteousness. He rules us through righteousness. That is, you will be doing righteousness, and all men who see you will know that you have grace because of the righteousness, which is opposite to sin. They say, well, they're sinning. Well, I sin, but by grace I go. No, that's a bluff language. That's not true. The grace will give you eternal life by righteousness, by living in righteousness. The Lord Jesus Christ will be doing all this in your life, and He will be controlling you. This is called grace. It is the only true grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. All other grace are false. Then in the first chapter, the name Begotten Son, and a few statements of John the Baptist, he gave a good witness about John, about Jesus Christ. It is all mentioned. Well, verse 3, that's in John, go to verse 29. The next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him, and says, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. That was John's witness, John the Baptist telling his disciples, and behold, that's the Lamb of God, taketh away the sins. Taketh away sin in the world is not the same as dying for the sins of the world. We all preach Jesus Christ died on the cross, and He was a sacrifice to take care of every sin. But it is not true. It is not so according to the Bible. But when you go to Leviticus chapter 16, book of the Leviticus in the Old Testament, let me read that book of Leviticus, verse 8 to 9 and 10. And Aaron shall cast lots upon the two goats, one lot for the Lord and the other is for the scapegoat. Aaron shall bring the goat upon which the Lord's lot fell, and offer him for a sin offering. One goat he sacrificed for a sin offering. But the goat on the which the lot fell to be a scapegoat shall be presented alive before the Lord to make an atonement with him, and let him go for the scapegoat in the wilderness. Then when you go to the explanation of the goat, the scapegoat, the other goat is given in verse 21. And Aaron shall lay both his hands upon the hands of the upon the head of the live goat, and confess over him. Watch it. It is the next goat. The churches, I never heard they teach in the churches. One goat is for sacrifice. That Jesus became a man, he came upon the cross, and he was sacrificed for the sins of the world. That's one thing. The other one, we never hear about it, but here it is. Aaron shall lay both his hands upon the head of the live goat, and confess over him all the iniquities of the children of Israel, and all their transgressions, and all their sins, putting them upon the head of the goat, excuse me, and shall send him away by the hand of the fit man. So that's the other goat. And one goat is to die, another goat carry all the things, all sins. Sacrifices are only for ignorant sins. If you go to the Bible, I don't have time to go through all the sacrifices this time. And you can write to me, or you can ask me any doubt, whatever it is, and I will reply promptly. Or you can just, email address is here. Jesus fulfilled both the lamb Why do we not teach these other churches? I don't know why. We don't have the time to explain it here now. Then 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 3 says that Jesus Christ died for our sins according to scriptures. Verse 4 says, and he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to scriptures. He rose again for what? What he rose again for? That's in Acts chapter 3 verse 26 says, having raised up Jesus Christ and sent him to bless you in turning away every one of you from their iniquities. Jesus Christ came twice, two times. First as a man to be a sacrifice, then being resurrected, came back here a second time to turn us away from our sins, or take away our sins, or carried away our sins. That is his second mission right away. First is a man, sacrifice, resurrected, come back right away and to turn us away the sin. The Jesus who's in omnipotent spirit, who's here with us now, to turn away our sins. Churches never teach that. The sacrifice sins are just for ignorant sins only, not every sins. But the takeaway sins will apply to every sin. That is according to the scripture. Somehow it's a mystery why the churches did not cover it. Our scapegoat to take away sin from us. John the Baptist, that's what he told his disciples. It is important to know that Jesus Christ has done everything according to scriptures, and it is very important that he takes away sin. It's good to know scriptures. By these times, a few disciples joined Jesus Christ. When they're coming back to John, a couple of disciples of John the Baptist have also joined Jesus. Andrew, who was a disciple of John the Baptist, told his brother Simon Peter that they have found the Messiah. Messiah have two missions. The Messiah will be cut off by the prophecies. That's Jesus Christ. Refers to his death on the cross. The other one is to reign in the millennium. And then he brought Peter to Jesus, and in verse 42, I think, let's go to John again. John 1, verse 42, and brought him to Jesus. And when Jesus beheld him, he said, thou art Simon, the son of Jonah. Thou shalt be called Kepha. In English they say Cephas, but as we read it as Kepha, which is the interpretation of a stone. So Simon is a stone, as a rock, according to Jesus. Verse 45, say, Philip findeth Nathanael and said unto him, it is John 1, 45, we have found him whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth is the son of... So he is talking about what Moses wrote about Jesus Christ. When Nathanael heard about what Jesus Christ said in verse 49, said, Nathanael answered and said unto him, Rabbi, thou art the Son of God and thou art the King of Israel. He was so excited by the answer of Jesus, and he was very much amazed. But few zealous men joined him as disciples. The 45, he says about the Moses, and then what is it about Jesus, what Moses told about? The reference is Deuteronomy chapter 18. Deuteronomy, that's again the Old Testament. I like to read that. Deuteronomy, that's also usually the Bible, it's not taught in the Bible. Verse chapter 8, Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 18, verse 18 and 19. I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren, like unto thee, and I will put my, God's prophecy, God's speak through, this is through Moses, Moses saying, I will put my words in his mouth, this is referring to Jesus Christ. And he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him. So Jesus, what was speaking was, Jesus also said, I speak what my Father is telling me to speak. So that is the reference. And Jesus spoke, God the Father, through the mouth of Jesus, is speaking. Here is a old prophecy, Moses speaking. And watch it, and verse 19, it shall come to pass, and that whosoever will not hearken unto my words, for God the Father speaking through Jesus, whoever did not hearken this verse, and shall speak unto my name, I will require of it. So that is a strong statement. And when you say, I will require of it, and God the Father will demand the people to obey the gospel preached by the Lord Jesus Christ. And if they rejected Jesus' words, that is rejecting God, so we will be thrown into hell for that rejection. So rejecting Jesus is rejecting what he spoke from not obeying. That is the scripture. Still, our preachers say that nobody can obey his preachings. His preaching is too hard. It is not possible to obey. So they believe and preach saying, just believe that he's died and resurrected for our salvation, then we have salvation. No, that is a false gospel. It is true that he died, it is true he resurrected, but believing that he died and resurrected will not take you to heaven. Obey what he say will take you to heaven. That is a difference. It is a kind of deception just to believe his death and resurrection to go to heaven. It will not take you to heaven. Live a righteous life by obeying him. So, please, let us obey the Lord Jesus Christ. Chapter 1 ends here. Then I will upload the next revision shortly. Then I will continue the chapter study. This time I determined to complete the whole thing. Thank you very much for listening. And God bless you and be with you all the time. And amen.